Welcome to Cascade Church. We exist to love God, love people, and live generously. We are a church committed to being followers of Jesus and being disciples who make more disciples. We have services in person here in Monroe at 8, 9:30, and 11:15 a.m. every Sunday. Come join us. Please open your Bible as we dive into God's Word today.
All right, today we are wrapping up our foundation series. We've been talking about the vision God has given us, the mission that we are on, partnering with Him in the Great Commission, and the message that we want the world to hear. And here at Cascade, something that I love about us is that we believe in the Word of God. Amen? That is something that has drawn so many here. We hold to it. It is the center for our understanding on all things. And that truth, that word, leads us to do what we just did, worship. We worship in the overflow of the truth we have found in Scripture, but it's our hope that we allow the Word to not only lead to worship, but to lead to a life of prayer and being intimately connected in a relationship with our Father. And that's what we're talking about today. How does prayer become foundational and something we cannot live without? So I have a friend, Jeremiah Porter, and he's going to be speaking today. He works with an organization, Fellowship 64, that helps churches create a culture of prayer and understand like what life in prayer is supposed to be about. So I'm excited for the word he's going to be bringing today and the experience we get to have tonight when hopefully you come back to practice this life of prayer together. So look at this as a little snapshot of what's going to happen tonight, and then Jeremiah will come up and share with us.
Good morning, church. It's great to be with you today, and I do hope that you will come out tonight for the prayer and worship service. There are rumors, and perhaps the rumor has made its way to you, and yes, it is true. The infamous Phil Clausen is my father-in-law. We are related, yes. Someone in the lobby came up to me and said, "Man, I'm really sorry." And I said, "Hang on, have you seen my wife? Do you know my wife?" Absolutely worth it. Absolutely worth it. Yeah, absolutely. Phil and Beth, love you guys. They're here. My family's here as well. I'm glad you guys are here. And I'm glad to be with you. I want to put you at ease this morning. I want you to know that for a lot of my life and a lot of my pastoral ministry, prayer was not natural to me. So if you're sitting here and you're thinking, okay, prayer, I don't know about this, okay, sounds cool, but I don't know, and I don't think I'm really good. I want you to know I know right where you're at. Don't worry. See, it was back in 2012 when all of a sudden God grabbed a hold of my heart. Up until that point, I'd been a youth pastor for a number of years, and I would, as I look back now, I would define myself then as a prayerless pastor. And you say, prayerless? Man, how'd you even get into the ministry? How'd they let you in? It's not that I never prayed, but it's that prayer was always something secondary. Prayer was always something kind of perfunctory, like you just do it because you have to do it, more out of duty. Well, you're supposed to start a church service with prayer, right? You're supposed to end the sermon in prayer. When you have meetings, there's supposed to be prayer. So yes, I prayed, but was I a prayer-driven leader? No. Was I leading a prayer-driven ministry? No. But it was when God had called us and was preparing us to take our first lead role in Oregon that my mentor had handed me a book titled Fresh Wind, Fresh Fire. He said, "You need to read this before you become a lead pastor." And so I read it, and God wrecked me in reading this, because it's the story of Jim Cimbala and the Brooklyn Tabernacle. And if you know that story, if you've read the book, you know that the door was on the church was on the verge of closing its doors. And Pastor Jim and his wife had been working on the church, trying to get something going, and nothing was happening, and to the point where Jim was getting sick. Like, he's so stressed out, he was getting sick. So God let them get away on vacation. While they were on vacation, God said to Pastor Jim, he said, "If you will teach my people to pray and seek my face, I will do things that right now you can't even imagine. You will always have something fresh to preach, and I will move with power among you in ways that only I will get the glory." And so Jim came back to his church and he said, "All right, church, here's the deal. I don't know what all this means, but here's the deal. From here forward, we will be a praying church. Prayer will be the number one thing that we do. It will define us. And I read this story, and I read the stories of what God was doing there and lives that were being changed. And I'm reading this, I'm going, man, I don't see this kind of transformation happening in my ministry, and I want that to happen. This has got to be a part. And then I started reading my Bible through a different lens and realizing, like, man, God's the God who does miracles. God's the one who does things that we can't even imagine, things that we feel like we can only hope for, but it's too big. It's too far out there. And I realized, oh, my goodness, God, you bet God can do this. And so all of a sudden there was a conviction shortly after that. I love how God works. He prepares the heart for then what he has next. And so it was shortly after that that I was introduced to the 6-4 Fellowship, which is an international multi-denominational network of pastors who are committed to prayer and the ministry of the word. That comes out of Acts 6:4, where the apostle said, we're going to devote ourselves to these things. And so I'm growing up and I'm learning to pray. I'm learning to lead others in prayer. It was beginning to change our youth ministry and the leaders in our youth ministry. There was an intimacy with God that was happening that had never happened before. All of a sudden, when I'm teaching it, I would often be so frustrated. Like, I'm teaching, I feel like I'm nailing it, and it's not changing the kids at all. And all of a sudden, things started to happen. God started to work in powerful ways. And now I have God's put in me a passion. I have the privilege of serving as the Northwest Regional Director for the 6-4 Fellowship, working with pastors and churches, helping them to build a culture of prayer. This is something I'm passionate about. That Jesus said, my house will be a house of what? Prayer. My house will be a house of prayer. And so it's a passion of mine then that I would be able to encourage you to become a praying church. Can I tell you a story real quick about what a praying church looks like? The power of a praying church. I had mentioned that God had led us to Oregon. I pastored a church there for about 6 years, and about 5 years in, there was an incident that happened. There was this kid in our ministry. He was real troubled, making all kinds of bad decisions, getting into all kinds of trouble, running with the wrong crowd. His mom was desperate for God to do something, pleading with the Lord, praying, calling upon the Lord, trying to share Jesus with her son. Her son would have none of it. One night, as he was hanging out with the wrong crowd, he was shot through the neck with a high caliber rifle, point blank, rushed to the ER. They were just barely hanging on to him, keeping him alive, got him stable enough that they could life flight him to Portland. And it was somewhere in there where I get the call that he's on his way. So I jump in my car, bring one of my elders with me. We go over to Portland and we visit. We can't see him. He's in the ER, and they're trying to figure out what to do, how to do surgery, and mom is there and just absolutely weeping. She's desperate for God to do something because her son doesn't know Jesus. Now, he very well may die. The doctors were not optimistic about the outcome of this. And so she's desperate. Not only does she want him to live, but she wants him to know Jesus. If he dies right now, he dies without knowing the Lord. And she'd been pleading with the Lord for years. So I bring that back to the church. That was Saturday night. I drive back home. I come to the church, and I don't even remember what I had preached that day, what I had planned to preach, but that sermon was scrapped. And I just said, church, we got to pray. Here's the situation. I tell them what's going on. I said, church, we got to pray. And so we got into groups, and we started lifting our voices to the Lord, people crying out to the Lord, people shouting out to the Lord, begging, pleading with the Lord to do something, keep him alive. So the next week I go out and I visit the mom, and the mom, she's smiling when I show up. I said, oh man, something happened. And I show up and she says, hey, he's gonna make it. Well, that's good news, man, praise the Lord. And she said, he's struggling to talk, but he surrendered his life to Jesus. So I go back to the church the next Sunday, and I said, hey, church, guess what? We sought the Lord. We prayed. We cried out to him. And you know what God did? He healed him. Woo! Everyone's rejoicing. And I said, hey, it gets even better. He surrendered his life to Jesus, and you should have heard the celebration in that sanctuary. And I believe the celebration would have happened anyway, but I believe that celebration was as loud and amazing as it was because when we prayed on that Sunday, when we weren't sure if he was going to make it, it wasn't just the pastor standing up in front of everybody and praying. That often is what can happen, right? Hey, church, here's the need. We need to pray. Let me pray, and then we'll get on with the rest of the show, right? How many of you know we're not here to put on a show? We're here to encounter God. Amen. Right? And so the church prays, the church ministers. So the church was a part of God doing that powerful work, not just observing it. Powerful. What God can do through a praying church and how prayer changes a church and that prayer experience changes the church. And I want you to know this, and this is what I'm praying for this morning, that you will understand this. You will come away from this morning with this, and that is that prayer must be the engine that drives you as a church family. Prayer must be the engine that drives you as a church family. There's too much at stake for that to not happen. 2 weeks ago, or over the last 2 weeks, Pastor Michael, as he had talked about, he'd been casting vision for 2024, right? Casting vision for your mission. What's your mission? To make disciples, right? Here in Monroe and in the communities beyond, right? To make disciples, see people come to Jesus, to help them grow in Jesus, that they too then would become disciple makers, disciples making disciples, right? That's the mission. How are you gonna do that? Last week he cast a vision for you, right? How are we gonna do that? We're gonna do it by living out our core values. We're gonna love God, we're gonna love people, and we're gonna live what? Generously. Love God, love people, live generously. I love that. Listen, that's God's plan for us. That's what God wants us to do. But it's going to happen in proportion to the prayer that happens in this place. Your mission success will happen in proportion to the prayer that happens in this place, the prayer that happens together. It is not enough for prayer to remain something secondary in your life any longer. There's too much at stake in your life. Things that need to happen in your life. Prayer cannot remain secondary anymore. It's not enough for prayer to be delegated to the leaders of the church and the prayer warriors in the church. There's too much at stake for that. If the mission is going to be accomplished, if those core values are going to be lived out, if you're going to grow in loving God, loving people, living generously, then you have got to become a praying church. You've got to continue to grow, I should say, as a praying church. Prayer must be the engine that drives you as a church family. Why? I want to share with you just three reasons why it's so important that you become a praying church. Not just a church that prays, but a praying church. Not a church that dabbles in prayer, but a church that is defined and driven by prayer. That it's something that you all do, you all become passionate about, you love to do, you can't wait to do. Three reasons why. Here's the first reason. Number one, God wants you to experience him. God wants you to experience him. First and foremost, God wants you to experience him. Yes, he wants to answer your prayer. Yes, he will answer your prayer. But first and foremost, God wants you to experience him. See, we come to God so often with a grocery list of prayers, of what we want God to do, what we need God to do, and we treat prayer like it's some sort of a transaction. Like we're coming to a spiritual ATM machine and, all right, here's what I need today. I need this much. Only as needed. And the problem with that is we often then will neglect prayer. Why? Well, on any given day, we just might not be thinking hard enough and we just, without really thinking about it, I didn't need anything from God today. I'm good. And sometimes out of pride, maybe. So we end up neglecting prayer. Or we become bored with prayer because it's just some sort of duty. It's just some sort of regular occurring thing that we do, and we just become bored with it. Or we become disheartened in prayer because God's not answering my prayers, at least not the way I think that they should be answered. And all the while, we're missing out on the most amazing thing about prayer, and that is that prayer is relationship with God. It's God inviting us into deeper relationship with him, an experience with him. And I'm not talking about something mystical. I'm not talking about some strange sort of abstract thing. I'm not talking about, although it's great in those moments and God does move with power, but I'm not talking about those moments where the band suddenly comes on strong back into the chorus out of a bridge and you get those goosebumps. No, I'm talking about when you pray, that in prayer, you are hearing the voice of God. That in prayer, you are actually feeling the embrace of God. Like you would when you go out to coffee with a friend or have someone over and hang out in the living room. You see each other face to face. You're looking into each other's eyes. You're hearing one another. You're embracing one another. That's what God has for you in prayer. In Psalm chapter 27, verse 8, the psalmist there says, I have heard you say, my heart has heard you say, come and talk with me. And so my heart responds, Lord, I am coming. Lord, I'm coming. I'm going to come and be with you. Your translation might say, my heart has heard you say, come and seek my face. And that word face is presence, God's presence. God's saying, hey, come and experience me. You know, in prayer and in that moment with God, that very real experience with God, there is where we also will hear God tell us exactly what he wants us to do. How many times have you prayed and you've kind of wondered, and maybe neglected prayer even, but you've just wondered, like, what does God want me to do? And you try this, you try that, and I can't figure out what God wants me to do. But in prayer, and if we will hang with God in prayer, he will show us what to do. I love how Alvin Reed defines prayer. He gives us this definition. He says, prayer is intimacy with God that leads to the fulfillment of his purposes. God wants you to fulfill his plan for your life. God wants you to fulfill his purposes. He wants you to fulfill his commands. He wants you to fulfill that mission to make disciples. He wants you to grow in loving him and loving people and living generously. He wants that to happen, and that's going to happen out of the overflow of our intimacy with him, which is why, first and foremost, he said, hey, just come and be with me. Let's be together, and then I will do. And it's not just individually. I want to encourage you with this. It's not just individually, but it's also together. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 18, where two or three are gathered as my followers, I am there among them. Listen, there is something unique. There is a unique manifestation of the presence of God when we pray together that you cannot and you will not experience by yourself. Now, let me clarify. As followers of Jesus, you have the Holy Spirit living in you. God is with you. He is always with you. There's no doubt about that. And when you pray, there is that experience with God, very real, very personal. But God also promises that, hey, when you all gather together and pray, I'm gonna show up in a powerful way. I'm gonna show up in a unique way. And so it's not only private prayer, but it's also prayer together that we experience God in that intimacy. I love what God is doing in our church in Granite Falls. We've been there almost 5 years now. It's called Granite Church. And we've been, from day one, working on leading the church to be a praying church, to have a culture of prayer. A culture of prayer means it's not just a program. It's not just a one-time prayer service once in a while, but it's through and through in our church, our kids' ministry, our youth ministry. On Tuesday nights, my wife leads our youth ministry, and we are teaching the kids to pray. They pray. It's not just us praying. They pray. We provide them with little prompts, and they're praying. In our services, if you were to come to one of our services, it's about an hour long, and on average, not always, but on average, we'll spend about 10 minutes in corporate prayer together where I'm out of the way. Nobody else is talking, but the church is praying together, sometimes out loud in unison, sometimes in small groups, but we are praying together. And I love it because even elementary age kids are now crying out to the Lord with adults around them, shouting out to God about how amazing and awesome it is, what they need from the Lord. They're learning to pray. They're learning the language of heaven. And it's awesome what God is doing. In Granite Falls, just like here, just like anywhere, there is all kinds of fear and anxiety. There's depression. There's all kinds of family dysfunction. There's abuse. There's just awful stuff. But we're seeing people be delivered out of those things as we seek the Lord in prayer and as we invite them to do the same. And it's not just us praying over them anymore, it's saying, hey, I want you to pray as well and teach them. And in that, they're experiencing an intimacy with God that they'd never experienced before when they start praying as well. And I love it now. So over the last, I don't know, 3 months, 4 months or so, just as this continues to grow, we're now seeing the highest retention rate of people coming that we've, I think, ever had before. Amen. And I love it because I follow up with them when they come back and say, hey, welcome back. You know, what brought you back? And it's always the same three things, maybe in different words, but it's always these three things. When I walked through the door, I was welcomed. Man, I hope that happened for you today. Someone said hi to you. And then they said, and you know what? It feels like a church family, because what happens is it's not just the pastor calling them the next week, hey, thanks for coming. It's someone else in the church following up with them, someone inviting them over for a meal, doing life together, and all of a sudden they're experiencing family. And here's the third thing, and I love this. Every single one of them, in their own words, is saying, and I feel like I'm actually encountering God here. They're not just showing up and receiving something, they're encountering God himself, and I love that. And that's happening as we are seeking the face of God in prayer. A prayer culture is vital, first of all, because God wants you to experience him. And without it, we'll miss out. Number two, you need what only God can do. You need what only God can do. How many of you know that Jesus was serious when he said, abide in me and you'll bear fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Do you believe that? And if we then evaluate our rhythms of time with the Lord then in word and in prayer, how does that reflect our belief of that? We need him. If you're really gonna grow this year in loving God, loving people, living generously, you're going to need God's help. Why? Well, I know for me, and I'm guessing for you, that the idols that control you, especially the idol of self, is powerful, and only God can set you free from that. Only God can set you free. The anger, hatred, bitterness that you might be experiencing, the division between you and another, only God can heal that. Only God can do that. If there's selfishness or entitlement in you, that's gonna keep you from living generously, only God can change that in you. You can't do that on your own. You can't muster up enough strength to do it on your own. I've tried too many times, for too many reasons, to muster up my own strength. I'm gonna do it, and I fail. And not until I turn to the Lord and I'm desperate for the Lord, and I'm calling out to him, and I refuse to quit until it changes in my life, does then that deliverance and that healing happen, and God is a God who can do that. He can do what only he can do. I love what A.W. Tozer says about prayer and seeking him. He says this, to desire revival and at the same time to neglect prayer is to wish one way and walk another. In other words, if you think about the things that you need to have happen in your life, or you're desperate for it to happen in a son's life or a daughter's life or your grandkids, that they need that spiritual breakthrough and turnaround in their lives. If you're desperate for that, but then neglecting prayer, you're wanting something and yet not really pursuing it, is what he's saying. Because we're not understanding the power of prayer. We need what only God can do. And when it comes to making disciples here in Monroe and beyond, only God can do that, because only the Holy Spirit has the power to change a person's heart. Psalm 127 verse 1 says this, unless the Lord builds the house, the laborers work in vain. Unless the Lord builds the house, the laborers work in vain. God's got a powerful work that he wants to do here, a powerful way in which he wants to use you. He wants to change you and through you to change the lives of hundreds, maybe even thousands of people around you. I believe, even I've told Pastor Michael this, that through a work that God wants to do here, he wants to change the culture of churches around you who are looking at you and saying, what are they doing that is so successful? And what if when they look this way, they said, what are they doing? What they saw was prayer. They saw a desperation for God. And God then doing what only God can do to come through and change the lives of people. Wouldn't that be awesome? You need what only God can do. Why is it that the church in Acts prayed so much? Think about this for a moment. Six times in the first six chapters, prayer is referenced in the book of Acts. From the very beginning, why was it that the apostles were hunkered down in a room praying? Was it because they were afraid of the world around them? No, Jesus said, stay here until the Holy Spirit comes. Then you will have power to do what I've called you to do. And they took Jesus at his word, and so they stayed and they prayed until God said, all right, let's go. Why is it that Peter and John are on their way to the temple in chapter 3? They're on their way to the temple for the daily prayer service. Why is it that the apostles in Acts chapter 6, when they were confronted with a programmatic problem in the church, they said, yeah, that's a problem, but we're not gonna get distracted by that. Here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna train up, we're gonna appoint some qualified leaders in the church to handle that, but we are going to continue to preach the word and lead the church in prayer. We're gonna continue to have prayer services. This is what matters most. They understood the most important program, if you will, is prayer, but it's gotta be more than a program. It's gotta be the culture of the whole church, every ministry in the church. And so they prayed, they understood this important truth that the Holy Spirit is the how-to. You cannot do what you need to have happen in your life on your own. Only God can do that. So a prayer culture here is vital, friends. It's vital because, number one, God wants you to experience him. And apart from growing in prayer together, you're gonna miss out on ways in which God wants to show up and show off. It's also because you need what only God can do. Here's the third thing. God conditions his actions on prayer. God conditions his actions on prayer. And you might hear right now, you might be thinking, whoa, wait, time out, wait a second. We believe in grace, that it's by God's grace. Absolutely. How about, I want you to think about it from this angle. God conditions his actions on prayer. That is grace. That is good news. That is God's blessing on us, that God has said, hey, when you call out to me, I am gonna hear you, I am gonna do. It's not, hey, call out to me, and as long as your formula is right, then I might consider responding to you. He says, no, cry out to me, and I will. I want you to turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 7. I've put single verses on the screen, but this one I want you to turn to, I want you to see it. And as you're turning there, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, as you're turning there, let me give you the context here. So Solomon has just finished building the temple, and now he's prayed this prayer of dedication with the assembly of God's people there, and prayed this prayer, God, may, in verse 40 of chapter 6, may your eyes be open, your ears attentive to all the prayers made to you in this place. Arise, O Lord, and enter your resting place. He's saying, God, let this be the place that you hang out so that we can meet with you, so that we can come and experience you, you and your power. Would you do this, God? And I love it because in the first three verses of chapter 7, it's exactly what God does. Three times there, it says that the glorious presence of the Lord filled the temple. And these were physical manifestations of the presence of God. How would you love to see that? I don't even know what that would look like here in the moment, but how would you like to see that? That you know without a doubt that right now God is here and he is moving with power. And that's what God is doing there. And then God says this to Solomon in verse 14. He says this, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sin and restore their land. My eyes will be open and my ears attentive to every prayer made in this place. This is in the context of the temple. This is in the context of prayer together. And God says, if you will pray, if you will humble yourselves and you will pray and you will seek my face, you will seek my presence, what you want more than anything is me, here's what's gonna happen. I'm gonna hear your prayers and I'm gonna forgive you of your sin and I'm gonna restore you. I'm gonna heal you. I'm gonna do a powerful work in your life. I'm gonna deliver you. I'm gonna rescue you. I'm gonna do what only I can do, God is saying. If my people will pray. God conditions his actions on prayer. Jeremiah 29, 12 through 14. You know verse 11, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. God's got good plans for you. How many of you know God's got good plans for your life? You know this? Yeah. Just a couple of you. Man, we gotta work on that. How many of you know God's got good plan for your life? Amen? God's got a good plan, but listen what he says next. In Jeremiah 29, 12 through 14, God says this, when you pray, I will listen. If you look for me wholeheartedly, you will find me. I will be found by you, says the Lord. This is a promise. This isn't a, hey, only if you get it right. This is a promise. If you seek me, if you want me, if you pursue me relationship with me, I'm going to do it. I will. Notice the if you pray, when you pray, I will. God says this over and over again. And it's not just the Old Testament, it's the New Testament. Jesus himself said it. Ask anything in my name, according to my will, in alignment with my heart, and I will do it. If you ask for the things that I want to do, I will do it. In Philippians chapter 4, Paul says this, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, pray with thanksgiving. And what's going to happen? You will have peace. You will have peace in your life. Despite the circumstances, you will have peace if you pray. God conditions his actions on prayer, but that is a wonderful, wonderful blessing. And I love how E.M. Bounds puts it, how he summarizes it. He says this, to no other activity is the promise of God committed as to that of prayer. God has made hundreds of promises in his word, but the number one activity, which we would do, that God says, if you do this, then I will. The number one activity is prayer. God has promised blessing in response to all kinds of things that he's called us to do in obedience to him, but the number one thing is prayer. It's vital that you develop a culture of prayer as a church family, because first and foremost, and if nothing else, God wants you to experience him. He wants to comfort you with his presence, with his love, with his embrace. He wants you to hear his voice. God can do what only he can do, and you need that to happen, and God conditions his actions on prayer. So a question I always finish my sermons with, my church knows this, and you're gonna get it now, is the question, here it is, so what? All right, good chat, you know? Some good points. So what? What difference is this gonna make in your life? What difference is this gonna make for you as a church family? James says, don't just be hearers of the word, be doers of the word. So what are we gonna do with this? And I want to encourage you with this. Start prioritizing prayer and never stop. Start prioritizing prayer and never stop. If you're not doing it already, if prayer is not a priority in your own life, in your own personal life on a daily basis, but not just that quick 5 minutes in the morning because you have to do it and I can check it off my spiritual to-do list. No, prioritize prayer in your life, throughout your life, throughout your day, prioritize it. Walking with God, talking with God. Yes, having those moments where you do nothing but sit and listen to God and his word and respond in prayer, but also as you go about your day, start prioritizing that. But not just individually, prioritize it together. Which is why Paul says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17, never stop praying together. Never stop praying together. There's too much at stake. Start prioritizing it and never stop. And you might quick turn your Bible there and you say, well, wait, mine just says pray without ceasing. Yeah, that is what it says. But you need to understand that command to pray, that command is in the plural. And almost every other command to pray in the New Testament is in the plural. In fact, the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, it's all in the plural. And somehow, for some reason, we have designated prayer as this private thing. And friends, we've been missing out. We've been missing out. Because there is a unique experience that God has for you when you pray together. There are unique ways in which God will answer prayer when you pray together. So Paul says, never stop praying together. Start prioritizing it and never stop. And I want to encourage you, if you're not already planning to come to the prayer service tonight, come. Do whatever you have to do to clear your calendar. Because God's going to meet with us. A bunch of you were here last time. We actually had to throw down more chairs than we thought were needed because a whole bunch of you came. But there were a bunch of you that didn't come and then you heard about it. And if you don't come again this time, you're going to hear about it again and know that you missed out. Because God has something special for us tonight. He's gonna meet with us in a unique way. He meets with you in your prayers. He meets with you in your small group when you pray. But there's something special that he has for us here tonight as well. And so I wanna encourage you, prioritize it. Prioritize it here on Sunday mornings. Prioritize it in your small groups. Prioritize it every time one of these prayer nights gets scheduled and announced. clear your calendar, do whatever you have to do. And it might be uncomfortable to do today to figure out how to clear that calendar, but I promise you this, if you do it and you show up, you'll be glad you did, because God has something special for us here tonight. Start prioritizing prayer and never stop. And God's gonna move with power here. So I always say to my church, I believe the best way to begin to apply this then to start down this road of prioritizing prayer is to actually do it. Pray it into action. All right, so here's what we're gonna do. I'm gonna ask you to get into small groups. Yes, you're gonna get into small groups, and yes, you're gonna pray. I don't end my sermons. So if you never invite me back, I'll understand why, but I don't end my sermons with just me praying, because you need to do business with God. You need to respond. You need to enter into that presence with him here in this moment and to do that together. Now, I'm gonna make it real easy. I know some of you are squirming and maybe wondering, where's the nearest exit? How do I get out of here? I don't like this already, but listen, I'm gonna put a prompt on the screen, two different prompts, one at a time. I'm gonna put a prompt on the screen. It's a simple fill in the blank. It's easy. If you don't know what to pray, you don't know how to pray, all you gotta do is pray the line and fill in the blank. Now, some of you are gonna feel like I'm boxing you in, like, man, you're only gonna let me pray one line because I only want you to pray that line. Don't go on, don't hijack this prayer time, just that one line. Why? Because we want everybody to be able to participate. And you might have someone in your group who's never done this before, never prayed in a group, never prayed out loud in a group, and they're gonna do it for the first time today, but you gotta give them that opportunity. And so the prompt is there to help them and to help you, and so that this is a great experience together. So that prompt is on the screen. Lord, thank you for hearing my prayer for, and pray that whole line and then fill in the blank, and then everyone in the group respond together. Just together, right where you're at, your faithful love endures forever. That's right out of 2 Chronicles 7, verse 3. Your faithful love endures forever. So here's what you gotta do. I want you to get in groups of 4, 5, 6. I don't want it to be a whole lot bigger than that, because we wanna maximize the participation. We only have a little time to do this. But you're actually gonna have to get up. You have to get up, you're gonna have to move. If somehow, some way, you're in the back and you're all by yourself, you need to move and get to someone. But it shouldn't be hard to get into groups right now. And I want you to go right to prayer. Don't talk about what's happening this afternoon. Don't talk about the answered prayer. Just pray it. Lord, thank you for hearing my prayer for. When was the time that God answered your prayer? Maybe the answered prayer was yesterday. Maybe it was last week. Maybe it was a year ago. But pray this prayer. Go right to prayer. Lord, thank you for hearing my prayer for. Your faithful love endures forever. Right to it, right to prayer. Lord, thank you for hearing my prayer for. And together, your faithful love endures forever. Pray one, let someone else pray. Pray again, because I hope God's answered more than one prayer in your life. Thank him. Lord, thank you for hearing my prayer for. The Lord's just continuing to draw that praise out of you. Stay with that one. But I'm gonna put the next prompt on the screen here. It's a request. And here's the request. Lord, make us a praying church so that. Lord, make us a praying church so that, and every time one person in your group prays that, would you collectively together say, for your glory, God? Because that's what it's all for, right? For your glory, God. Lord, make us a praying church so that, what do you want God to do? What do you know God wants to do? And say, Lord, so that that happens. Lord, make us a praying church so that, for your glory, God. Would you do that? Father, I thank you that you are true to your word. Lord, as has been said here in these prayers, Lord, you have answered our prayers. Thank you, Lord. So many different ways in which you've answered prayer, and so many, Lord, that we just wouldn't have time right now even to praise you for. But Lord, you are the one who hears when we call upon you and you answer. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for that promise, Lord. And Father, I ask that indeed, your hand would be on the Cascade family, that you would make this church family a praying church so that, Lord, so that they would in fact grow to love you with all their heart, full devotion to you, with joy, with passion. Lord, that they would love one another and love people, love this world, the people. Father, make the Cascade family a praying church family so that the thousands around, the tens of thousands around us might come to know you, Jesus. Lord, make this church family a praying church family for your glory, God. In Jesus' name, amen.